The scripture today is Titus chapter 3, verses 3 through 8. Titus chapter 3, verses 3 through 8. And I'll be reading in the King James Version. And it says, "For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers, lusts, pleasures, living in malice, and envy, and hateful, and hating one another. But after that, the kindness of the love of God, our Savior, toward men appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable unto men."
Excited about next Sunday. Next Sunday, John Smith is going to be with us talking about the Holy Spirit and especially about worship during this time. So be sure to come, invite some of your friends and neighbors to be able to come just to be able to hear him. He is one of those amazing guys who has taught for a very long time, and he has so many things he has done in his life and such a good way of being able to explain. He's just very down to earth, very practical, and has a really good way of being able to tell about God and about our life and about how things work. And so I'm looking forward to that. I hope you are as well. Looking forward to Wednesday night. That's going to be a lot of fun. That's going to be a good thing. So there's food Wednesday night and there's food on Sunday. So make sure that you realize that. Now the food Wednesday night you don't have to bring. The food Sunday you need to bring. Okay? Everybody got that? So this is a potluck, and what that means is you bring something to share, and then you get to dip into somebody else's pot. And so that's always a good thing, because they're going to bring something really, really good. And that's always a good thing to be able to do. So lots of time to be able to be together and enjoy. What happens if you are in Starbucks or whatever your favorite coffee place is, and just as you're about to go in and get your favorite drink, somebody comes out and they're holding a cup and they say, "You can have this. Are you going to drink it?" No? A lot of you guys are suspicious. Does it matter if they're holding it by the bottom and go, "You know what, you can have this, I just can't drink it"? Or if they're holding it by the top going, "You can have this." Or if they're kind of laughing, say, "You can have this." Or if there's people behind them, you laughing when they give it to you. And, you know, it kind of depends, doesn't it? They're giving you something for free, right? It's a gift. Do you want it? Sometimes we're pretty suspicious. I'm not sure I want that. Even though it's something for free, even though we're walking into the very place where we would buy that, we're going, "No, I don't want yours." Which is a very interesting comment on us and on our society, that we would buy ours, but I'm not sure what you did to yours. And so I don't know how much salt you poured in it. I don't know how much. Yeah, there's just a whole list of things that can happen. So we want to talk a little bit about Christianity today, because I think people have the same concept. They walk in and we'll say, "You can have my grace." And they go, "I'm not sure I want that." But it's free. It really is. You can have it. And they're like, "Not so sure I need that kind of grace." But let's talk about what the Bible says about it first. I want you to know here's the thing that God tries to express, and here's what grace is really all about, as Titus puts it in such a succinct form. He talks about the time when we were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to passion, slaves to pleasure, wants, desires. We hated everybody. We made enemies all over the place. There were all kinds of places where we did not keep good relationships. And every relationship we had, we kind of destroyed. And so when that gets to that place, you realize the problem isn't everybody else. The problem is at home. The problem is us. And he says that's really where people had gotten to. They were terrible people. They were selfish people. They just did what they wanted and then wondered why their relationships all failed. Well, naturally they're going to fail if you're like that. And he says, but the good news is the kindness of God appeared. What a great statement. The kindness of God appeared and his love appeared and he saved us. What an incredible thing. He saved us because of who he is. He saved us because he's a loving God. He saved us because he's the one that knows. And he saved us, as you look at this, not because of works that we have done, but it is by, and he lists this several times, not by works we have done, but according to or by his mercy. That's the way he did it, because he is not going to count things against us. It was also by regeneration. So what's regeneration? Well, regeneration is going to be when you wash something. Washing of regeneration is to put it back to where it was before. When you wash something, you use soap, you use water, you wash it, and it comes out clean again. And so he's using that kind of same thing of we're going to take it and wash it and make it clean, but I'm not sure a bath is going to help us with our sin. So he says it's regenerating it back to where it was before. Makes it just like it was. And so this washing of regeneration, this taking away of old sin, this cleansing of bad habits, and taking out all the things of which we're ashamed, and we kind of try to hide those things. We don't want people to see those. We want them to think we're nice, so we smile a lot, and we try and cover up all that other stuff. All of those things, he says, that's what he did, is he took away all of those things. It takes baptism and repentance. That's what the washing of regeneration is really all about. That's what we understand through all the examples that we see. And it's also by renewal of the Holy Spirit, because it wasn't just enough to cleanse us the first time and to make us all new and pretty and clean again, and then you know what's going to happen in a day or two. For some of us, it doesn't even take a day or two. It's just going to all go downhill. And we're going to go back to the same thing again. We're going to go back to yelling at people. We're going to go back to being terrible to other people. We're going to go back to wanting just what we want. But he says, I'm going to give you my Holy Spirit so that he can come in and he can change how you live. He can change from the inside who you are. Because he is able to plant inside of you something that grows and that produces this fruit, which is more love, joy, peace, patience. And if you've never been a patient person and wondered, how can I ever have patience? This is the way you get it. Washing of regeneration and renewal by the Holy Spirit means it renews you to be the best person you can be. Where all those things that you blame from your past, maybe you had a bad home life, maybe you had people that just hated you, maybe everything in the world has been against you. None of that matters anymore, because God has put something better inside of you. And this kindness, this goodness, this self-control that he's able to put into our life really means we are able to have that. Not just as a physical thing, I'm going to have self-control, I'm going to hang on, I'm not going to say what I want to say. He says, no, he's going to change you so that your heart is different now. That we are justified by grace, that's how he describes this. Not that he declares us innocent, really. I mean, we know better. We're not going to be innocent. But we're justified. We no longer have it. It's no longer against us. It's not that we never committed it. I don't think anybody's going to believe that about us. But it's the fact that it has been paid for. It's been taken away, and we no longer have that as a debt against us. Nothing is held against us. We're free to become whoever we want to become. And not only that, but he's added us to his family. He paid the price for us, and it's an invitation to be like him and among his relatives and to be one of his people. And he says, because of that, we devote ourselves to good work. Because he's done so much for us, we start simply by doing good things, and then we realize we're trying to act like him. We're trying to be the same way to the world that he has been to us. And so we start acting the way God would act. That's grace, salvation. And that's what he does. And it's all as a gift to us. It's nothing we did to make it possible, because he's the one that gave first. He's the one that allowed that. He's the one who's a God who comes and says, I'm just going to love you. And it's up to us to do what we want. We could turn it down. Just like a cup of coffee, say, no, I don't think I want that. I don't think I like people being nice to me. I don't think I want anything to do with you, God. And a lot of times I think people do turn it down and we're shocked. What? But a lot of times it's just like you. It's a free cup of coffee. It's right there. It's the same flavor you would have gotten. Yeah, but what's the catch? And we're always suspicious of what's the catch. And some people are suspicious of God. I'd rather have my own guilt that I know about rather than some kind of thing where you say I'm going to be okay and then later on you're going to expect me to pay you for it. It all sounds too good. So where is this uncomfortable part? I see it in a couple of different ways in which some of these have happened just recently, in fact. Some people have come and the problem is commitment. A commitment you can walk away from isn't really a commitment. It's a commitment with a back door. If you could just have that, that would be great. Because that's really what I want. I want to come in, get a little bit of Jesus, ask him into my heart, and then I'm going to go out and do whatever I want to do. Does that sound good? And then we start saying, well, but there's this Bible that you need to read and you need to follow. It's the guide. It's the things that he has said that we need. Yeah, I didn't really want that part. Not so much. I thought I could just come in and you know, be a Christian. I'll come once in a while. And we'll be good. I mean, God loves me. That's what I see everywhere. Every football stadium, signs on the corner, every place. God loves me. So if God loves me, then I'm good. Because after all, I don't really need to have all this churchy stuff. I'm not sure I really want all that. And so we see people who are uncomfortable with grace because they think something is expected. God isn't going to force somebody to take something good. They don't want to come to church. They don't want to pray. They don't want to read their Bible. Have you seen how thick that book is? I mean, it's not easy. Especially if you've got the version Ezekiel's got. Goodness. Trying to read that one makes it even more difficult. They just want to be baptized and go on their way. If God loves me, I'll be fine. It's all up to me. And they miss the point. They miss the fact that God can do so much more. Because God does not offer that kind of grace. We get uncomfortable when we're around religious people. You ever been there? This kind of religious people? Yeah, sometimes they're nice, like you guys are being nice right now. You're all sitting very calm. Nobody's pointing their finger. Nobody's screaming. But, you know, at any moment, it could break out. You know how those religious people are. When they get something up their sleeve, they decide, I'm going to jump on this. And we don't want to be around somebody who's going to yell at us. Sometimes we just don't even want to be around somebody who's good. Because they're going to talk about how bad, and I'm going to feel bad. And now you're hearts. In fact, sometimes I just want to be selfish, because if I'm selfish, I control it. That I can control everything in my life. It's my agenda, and I can do that. And I don't like all these church people, because they're always trying to be good. And I'm always suspicious. Like that cup of coffee. What's really in there? What's really going on with those people after all? They're trying to act all loving and kind, and you just never know. They're going to stab you in the back somewhere. I know the world doesn't work that way. You never get anywhere that way. Sometimes they just wish we would sin a little more so that they would feel better about themselves, because after all, you never want to be the worst person in the room. And that's why you make friends that are just a little bit uglier than you are, right? Friends that, you know, are just not as nice as you are, so that people will say, oh, you're really the good one. Yeah, that's great. I need friends that make me look good. And I look good because they look so bad. Wrong way to do it. But I think we live in a world like that, where people will do things that way, and they are more comfortable around sin and more comfortable around people that they know are going to cheat them than they are around people who are genuinely trying to be good. They can't really believe it. I am uncomfortable with race, that somebody would accept me right where I am. I think that's really why Jesus chose the disciples that he did. They were not the religious leaders. In fact, they didn't even look very holy. They're fishermen. They kind of stink. You know, that's the way it happens. None of them are angels. And Jesus changed them. I think we need to be real people. The third reason I think we get uncomfortable with grace, and this maybe comes from our side, is we just can't have people keeping on sinning, you know. And so there's got to be some punishment. If they aren't punished for it, then something's wrong. Righteous living is all about punishment. Because if they aren't punished for things, then how do we ever expect them to stop? Right? I mean, you wouldn't stop doing something that's sinful, that you just like to do, just because somebody says, you ought to be good. I love you. I want you to be a better person. I'm going to put my spirit in so that you can be loving and patient and kind. No, they're never going to change unless the pain is there, right? And so we think that's really what grace is about. Somewhere hiding underneath all of this is this guy, right? That guy who's going to be able to scream and yell and give us the punishment we deserve, right? People can't just decide to do right just because they love. Just because it's to their benefit, just because it would avoid bad things. We all think we're the exception. We can handle it. And so I think our world is very uncomfortable with grace. But it's not so different from ours and from the time that we read about in the New Testament. We read the theory pages, but let me give you one that's the practical page of what Paul actually went through. He's on a missionary journey in Acts chapter 13. And he's in Antioch of Pisidia. He's come to a Jewish synagogue, and he goes in to try to explain to them about their Messiah, that Jesus has already come, he was their Messiah, and that he was crucified on the cross, and now God's fulfillment is all there. And so they hear that a little bit, and then they're not so sure, and he's coming back the next week. And so it says, the next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. And when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy and began to contradict what was spoken by Paul, reviling him. Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, saying, it was necessary that the word of God be spoken to you first. Since you thrust it aside and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life, behold, we are turning to the Gentiles. For so the Lord has commanded us, saying, I have made you a light to the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. When the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord, and as many as were appointed to eternal life believed. They got jealous. Can that happen in grace? Can you get jealous? Seems like it. Here's the religious leaders of their time and Paul coming as one of them to try to explain, here's what's happened. This is great news. The Messiah you've been looking for is now here. He's already come. He's already... And they're going, yeah, we don't think that's right because of it. And you can always argue religion. I'm not sure why it's like that. But you can always argue religion. Somebody's got a different idea. Somebody's got a different place. And so they start the argument. They start contradicting. Why? Because people are listening to Paul. We can't have that. We can't have them actually doing what he wants. And so, sure enough, you look at uncomfortable grace going on. They are very uncomfortable with what Paul is trying to preach about grace. He would have said those same things in Titus that we read at the beginning. And they're like, well, we can't have this. We're more about law and about obedience and all of those things than we ever are about grace. So they reject the word of Paul. He gives them the quote from Isaiah 49:6. Obviously a passage they don't use very much because it talks about turning to the Gentiles, and that makes them even worse. And a lot of Gentiles must have come there because then it says the Gentiles get very excited about this. This is great. What? You mean we could be saved? Who ever heard of such a thing? That a God of Israel, a God that parted the Red Sea, a God that gave them a new land, a God that we see as such a powerful God might actually want and allow us to become part of Him? That we could come to Him? They've never heard of such a thing. And they are so excited about it. And as many as believed. Well, what a great thing. They all say, well, let me, count me in. I want that kind of grace. Do we see that same reaction today? Most of you are Gentiles. Not your fault. It's just where we are. Mesa, Arizona. City of Gentiles. Most of the people you're going to go out of here and try and talk to about Jesus Christ are going to be Gentiles. And if you say to them, there is a God of grace who loves them, and His kindness has brought to them the renewal of the Spirit, the washing of regeneration, to allow you to be one of His children, to be involved in His family. Are they going to be excited about it? Just about like that cup of coffee. Yeah, I know. And where's your collection plate? Right? We're suspicious. I wish we had this, where if we just, made the announcement, and it seems like they had that in the early days of the church, especially when Gentiles were brought in, how great that would be. This would be such an exciting thing that you could be excited about grace, but I don't see that happening today. I mean, just being realistic about it, people become very uncomfortable with that. What church are you from again? Do I really have to have that? People are uncomfortable with grace. He finishes the passage and he says, and the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region, but the Jews incited the devout women of high standing and the leading men of the city and stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and drove them out of the district. And they shook off the dust from their feet against them and went to Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. They were rejected. Because they kind of stirred up all the leading people, both men and women in the city, and they bring up persecution, and it's because we're uncomfortable with this grace you're talking about. But you can tell Paul's filled with grace because that doesn't even bother him. He says, okay, we'll go on to somewhere else. We'll go on to the next place. He doesn't let people who don't understand get him down. Because he has a little more grace to share. Let me give you an illustration of how this works. I think we understand it a little bit. We're better with the idea of love. So let me just start there and talk about what love is. you see someone and, oh, they just look so wonderful, so great. And you walk up to them and you say, I love you. And they call the police. No, it doesn't quite work like that. Okay, let me back up a little bit. You see someone and you think they look so great, and so you're very cautious about this approach, and you're nice to them, and you try to get close to them because you care about them, you genuinely love them. And after a little while, don't push too fast, after a little while, they start responding to that. Why? Because I decided I like them. I like everything about them. I like the way that they look. I like the way that they laugh. I like everything about them. What an incredible thing it is to be able to get to know this person, how wonderful they are. And they start responding back, and pretty soon we're in love, and pretty soon we make vows, and we want to be married, and it's all about this relationship, and we promise to live a certain way. We promise to be patient and kind, just like the Bible says. We promise to endure in life, in, you know, sickness and in health. And so all of those things go through this. We're no longer selfish. We're no longer arrogant or rude. We're no longer about ourselves. We're all about them. And their normal response back is that somebody loves me. Somebody cares about me. And so the response back is love also. It costs your emotions. It costs your belief. It costs some work and some perseverance. It changes your schedule. It changes your life. It changes the way you talk. It changes where you spend my money, because free love costs you both. And we believe in that, and we like that, and we hope for that. Because we act like a person who's loved. We respond with that same kind of love. That's how great it is. We love those who love us. That's fairly easy to do. It's harder to love the other ones, but we love people who love us. Take that same thing and apply it to grace. It's really what happens. We see it all the time. We hope for it with love. We understand it with love. What if we could just get the idea that it works with grace also? That there is somebody who has grace for us and decided to give it. God's grace is free, but it's not cheap. It cost Jesus his life. And then he died on the cross, and his death was to pay for our sins and for the whole world's sins. It's a huge price for Jesus to pay, but he did that before we even asked, and he just decided, seeing us from a long ways off, you know what, I'm going to love that person. I'm going to be offering grace to that person so that forgiveness can take place, so that they can be redeemed from their past sins, so that it's all possible, and he pays that price for us. And we even see him as he's on that cross saying, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. And a response to grace is the same. It's expected, right? I think we don't know how to respond to grace. And a lot of times we're suspicious and say, I don't know that I want that. That's too big. I don't want you dying for me. Buy me a new cup of coffee where I can watch them make it. But what if we just simply respond with grace? That forgiveness is painful. And we make sure that forgiveness is followed, and that we've been redeemed because he wants to redeem us. And so we're going to act like we've been redeemed. And so we put away sin, and we put away all those things because it's something that he's giving to us. And we may be a little suspicious at first and not really want to trust it, but we realize that we live up to the grace that he has given to us, and we give grace back. And after a while, we believe the forgiveness, and we forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. They don't know what it's like to have a person who really has grace for us. And we can see examples of people like Paul who have persecuted the church until grace was given. You know, blinds you for a little bit and it gives you some better sense. And now he forgives and he doesn't persecute. And he preaches grace and he offers grace and he forgives people because he was forgiven. He didn't fight those other people in Antioch. He just went on to the next city and says, I've got more grace to offer. So what if we did respond to God? What if we treated people like we want to be treated? What if God loved and we responded by loving him and we responded by loving others? And what if grace from God was met with grace from us and we explained to other people how it feels to be completely forgiven and free from all sin? What if church was coming and you weren't suspicious of all the people and why they're here and what they're after and what they're trying to do? What if you found a loving place of grace where you could really trust me? Can we get there? I think so. But it takes somebody to respond to that grace that he gives. God has already started. He's already given it. He's already there. It takes somebody who's going to trust that and be able to decide, yeah, I'm going to act that way. Let me read to you a story. It's about Fiorella LaGuardia, who was the mayor of New York City during the worst days of the Great Depression and all of World War II. He was called adoring by New Yorkers the little flower because he only stood 5'4" and he always wore a carnation in his lapel. He was a colorful character. He used to ride to New York City fire trucks, raid the speakeasies with the police department, and take entire orphanages to baseball games. Whenever the New York newspapers were on strike, he would go on the radio and he would read the Sunday funnies to the kids. One bitterly cold night in January of 1935, the mayor turned up at night court that served the poorest ward in the city. LaGuardia dismissed the judge for that evening and he took over the bench himself. Within a few minutes, a tattered old woman was brought before him, charged with stealing a loaf of bread. She told LaGuardia that her daughter's husband had deserted her. Her daughter was sick and her two grandchildren were starving, but the shopkeeper from whom the bread was stolen refused to drop the charges. It's a real bad neighborhood, Your Honor, the man told the mayor. She's got to be punished to teach other people around here a lesson. LaGuardia sighed. And he turned to the woman and said, I've got to punish you. The law makes no exception, $10 or 10 days in jail. And even as he pronounced the sentence, the mayor was already reaching into his pocket. And he extracted a bill and he tossed it into his famous sombrero, saying, here is the $10 fine, which I now remit. Furthermore, I'm going to fine everyone in the courtroom 50 cents for living in a town where a person has to steal bread so that their grandchildren can eat. Mr. Bailiff, collect the fines and give them to the defendant. So the following day, the New York City newspapers reported that $47.50 was turned over to a bewildered old lady who had stolen a loaf of bread to feed her starving grandchildren. 50 cents of that amount being contributed by a red-faced grocery store owner, while 70 petty criminals, people with traffic violations, and New York City policemen, each of whom had just paid 50 cents for the privilege of doing so, gave the mayor a standing ovation. So what if grace was real? What if it just took us doing it? If God has given it to us, what's our response? We can be forgiven. We can be redeemed. We can be these people who are able to be so honest and so open and so caring. But because we have a God who's done that for us, would it change the world? Might make other people uncomfortable, especially the ones trying to get away with things. But I really think it'd make a huge difference. So what if this was a great day? What if this is your grace day? What if this is the time when God loves you and God forgives you and you're ready to accept His grace? Because He's loved you for a long time. Maybe you need to just be able to pray for forgiveness, or maybe you need to be baptized into Christ, that washing of regeneration that can take place so that His filling of that Holy Spirit can be yours. Whatever it is, I want today to be a day that you rejoice in the grace of God. Would you sing while we stand?